great to see everyone here. I'm Insha Rahman. I'm the Vice President of Advocacy and Partnerships at the Vera Institute of Justice, and I have the distinct honor of getting to moderate our last panel for the day. What we're going to talk about with this terrific panel is to get into not only some of the numbers, but the stories, and as well as touch on, as we have earlier today, the policies and the politics. And so you've heard already today many important and incontrovertible facts about the impact of bail reform. There are close to 30% fewer people behind bars as a result of bail reform. That's, on any given day, over 8,000 New Yorkers who are free to go home to their families, to their communities, to their jobs, and not suffer the harms of pretrial detention. When I say there's been many important and good impacts of pretrial reform, like the far fewer number of people behind bars, one thing that hasn't changed is the racial composition of who is incarcerated. So before bail reform in New York, the jail population was about 58% black. After bail reform, it's 60% today. And what we also know is, you know, the overall population in New York State of over 19 million people, only close to 16% of the overall population is black. So that's how, from the numbers, how prevalent racial disparities are when it comes to our pretrial system. And so let's turn to this panelist and get into the conversation. I just wanted to set out a little bit of the framing about why we're focusing on racial justice, on racial disparities, as we're having this particular conversation about bail reform and pretrial justice. And so to my left, I have the Honorable Russ Immarigeon, who is a town and village court justice in the town of Hillsdale, which is in Columbia County, upstate. And I'm really excited for us to have the upstate perspective on this panel. I think it's a really important, vital perspective to have. And then we have Katie Schaffer, who is the Director of Organizing and Advocacy at the Center for Community Alternatives, and then Assemblymember Phara Souffrant Forrest, who's representing parts of Brooklyn up in Albany. And then last but not least, Stan Germán, the Executive Director of New York County Defender Services.
So let's talk a little bit about what it means when somebody is incarcerated pretrial. So at a constitutional level, it means that we've sort of fundamentally violated their presumption of innocence, that arraignments last 30 seconds or a minute, there is no finding of guilt, and this person is then behind bars, either on bail they cannot afford, or in cases where they've been remanded. And there is sort of a violation of one of our fundamental protections. Secondly, people don't exist in a vacuum. People have families, people have children, people have jobs, people have houses or apartments, people have a whole constellation, a whole world. And if you think about your own life for a minute, you think about your job, your family, your kids, your world, what would it mean if you were disappeared from your life for a day, for 3 days, for a week, for 2 weeks, for a year, for 3 years? Who picks your kid up at school? What happens to your financial aid when you can't attend class? What happens to your dog? What happens to your elderly parents that you take care of? So there's a whole universe of people who are impacted by your removal from your life and your placement in a cage. Then there is the consequences for the outcomes of your case. That one of the things that happens when people are incarcerated pretrial is that there is a fundamental perversion of our access to justice. In New York State, 98% of cases are resolved through guilty plea. 98%. And so when we think about your constitutional right to a trial, in practice, that is not real in New York State. And there is a sort of a system of laws that have led us to that statistic, but pretrial incarceration is a very meaningful part of that. That when somebody is incarcerated pretrial, the pressures to plead guilty, whether or not you have done the harm you're accused of, are very strong. So one of our members, I'll give an example of his experience. He's from Long Island. He was in New York City as a teenager. He was pulled over in a car with a group of other teenagers, and drugs were found in the car. They weren't his drugs, but all of them got arrested, this group of teenagers in this car. Bail was set at $4,000. He didn't have it. His single mom, raising other kids as well, didn't have it. And he spent 3 months on Rikers Island. After 3 months, the prosecutor came to see him and said, if you take this guilty plea, we'll give you time served and you can go home tomorrow. And he said, but I didn't do anything. And the prosecutor looked at this child and said, you can spend the next year and a half in here telling people how you didn't do anything. And so what does he do? He takes that guilty plea, he goes home, and now he has a felony record. So this child, just beginning his life, is now going to have a harder time accessing housing, accessing a job, accessing education. And that is the coercive power of pretrial incarceration. You know, Khalif Browder's name has been invoked here already. Khalif did something unusual. It's not that his case was unusual. It's not that somebody accused of something who was sitting in jail because they couldn't afford it was unusual. What was unusual about Khalif Browder's case was that he refused to take that guilty plea, that he was willing to sit in jail for 3 years, refusing to take that guilty plea. That is an unusual amount of fortitude, and one that deeply cost him when he took his life a few years later. So that is the way that a system in which people are incarcerated pretrial perverts a system of justice, perverts the outcomes of their cases, as well as having an incredibly detrimental impact on the people in their lives.
Katie, I actually wonder if after bail reform, that case you described of the member who took a plea on charges that involved drugs wouldn't have had bail set, because that would now be an ineligible charge for bail, and the trajectory of his case and his life might be very different today. So Farah, I saw you both raise your hand, and then also you have spent time visiting Rikers Island, so getting concrete again about Jail. I think there's a microphone for everybody. We don't even have to share.
Plentiful microphones.
Lots of microphones. So please take that microphone and tell us about the visit to Rikers Island, how this connection between bail reform and the growing crisis at Rikers, how is it connected? And specifically, do you think there's a connection between the backlash to bail reform and just how bad the crisis at Rikers is getting? And it is worse today measurably than it was before bail reform happened. And I'm curious what you would say about the connection between the backlash to bail reform and the growing crisis in our jails, and Rikers is not alone in that way.
So while Katie was talking, it the statistics of what you had mentioned, 60% of bodies behind bars are black and brown baddies, right? But then it's only 16% of the population. So what that makes me think of is when I left New York City to go visit my brother and friends, first time in a European country, and I'm walking through Paris, and I'm like, oh my God, there are so many beautiful black men. Now, but listen to what I'm saying. I, being a black woman with a bachelor's degree, walking through New York City, Brooklyn, I've never felt like, not only am I just looking, but I'm looking and seeing what's eligible for me, what's there, the diversity, the what's the pickings that I could have. And so when you see that, whoa, wow, that was like, oh, shoot. So that's what 60% looks like behind jails, because they're not in the community. That's a fact. A best friend, a potential boyfriend, a potential friend, an uncle, they're not in the community. They're not there. They're just gone. They're disappeared, as Katie said. And so when we talk about bail reform, the need for bail reform, and we understand that locking up black bodies behind jail, because behind prison jail bars, simply because they cannot afford to be out in the street, then you see that, okay, not only are we talking about housing, healthcare, and all of the issues that we have, we're talking about people unable to maintain, criminalizing poverty, basically. And so now I'm like, okay, so bail reform is very important for us to maintain, and how do we do that as a legislature? How do we prepare for that? And I have to say, the members, my colleagues, were prepared. You know, we were thinking that we know that 2019, 2020, 21, the backlash is there. There's the conversation, so we're ready to hold the line. But then when the executive put out her budget, we're like, oh, okay, bail reform is not there. I mean, rollback on bail reform is not there, so we're going to relax. Until, what, 13 days before it was due? We were very upset. Because this is not what was promised to us. This was not up for discussion. I want everybody to understand, 13 days before, that means we read through the whole yellow book, the first book, we wrote another book, whatever, to write out the budget. And none of this for bail reform was up for even discussion until 13 days before the budget. And now we were scrambling to make up messaging to respond. And that was very upsetting.
Yeah. Well, and what we have seen, and we've suffered now two rounds of amendments and rollbacks to bail reform in 2020. And then again, as you were saying, Farah, just in this budget session in March into April. But yet, bail reform is still in effect. There are a significant thousands fewer people behind bars today. And what we're seeing is that it's still under attack, right? The headlines have not gone away. Do you want to jump in and say more?
The bail reform is still there, but there is little chips at the armor, right? And there's this one part that we kept on talking amongst ourselves, which is the dangerousness standard, the idea that you could look at someone and based on their the where they live, where they eat, and then predetermine whether or not they were a risk to the community. And when we look at who the New York Post often pegs as like who's dangerous, and remember, judges, juries, prosecutors are all human. They're reading the same stories too. They're going to see that, okay, well, black man from Whitman houses, 22-year-old, didn't finish high school. Oop, boop, that's dangerous. That person then is not eligible as everyone else.
Yeah. And we can talk a little bit about the dangerousness conversation because I think it is complex and difficult to get around. One thing I do want to say is people have a right to feel safe, and the public safety conversation is a really important one because if public safety doesn't feel real, then support for reforms erode. I mean, that is what we are seeing loud and clear. And so, Stan, I want to turn to you because, Farah, you talked about the New York Post, and we can't ignore the role of media in shaping our perceptions of safety and whether bail reform is working or not. I'd love for you to speak to a couple of examples of that and why is that in that way? And also, what does it do? What's the impact of the sort of disparate coverage when it comes to bail cases, people accused of a crime, and then our, you know, perception of public safety?
So if it's okay, I'm going to stand up because I think we're going to have some slides. And by the way, the assembly member and I did not coordinate this. So it was a perfect transition. I'm serious about that. And so, you know, what I really want to talk about is the racialized politics around bail reform. And I was thinking about, you know, how best to portray it, and I got all kinds of data, and my data team was working, you know, overtime to get me the data, and they're going to be disappointed that I went in another direction. And so what I did was I wanted to take two very prominent cases that were in the media in the last several months and really, you know, illustrate this, you know, really in black and white, and how the discussion, the perception, the media coverage around bail reform plays out, and particularly in New York City. And so this young man here, his name is Cameron Williams. Cameron is an aspiring rapper, and more than aspiring, he's actually got a signed contract at the age of 16. His handle is CBlue from the Bronx. I am not familiar with CBlue. I did want to go on YouTube and see his video that apparently got like 2 million views or something, and I'll do that. But for purposes of this discussion, CBlue was standing on a corner hanging out with the fellas in the Bronx when he was approached by police officers. The police officers claimed that they were acting unruly and suspicious and all of these things. And he got what I would say was manhandled and searched. Mr. Williams did have a loaded weapon in his pocket. Nobody knew that when he was stopped. And during this kind of back and forth, the gun accidentally went off, striking Mr. Williams in his leg and also striking the police officer. And so those are the facts of his case. On the other side of the spectrum, we have Lauren Panzienza, somebody that the media has described as a socialite, apparently comes from a family of means in Long Island. This young woman is accused of pushing an 87-year-old senior citizen in Chelsea to her death. I don't know the facts, and I'm not here to condemn anybody, but from what I read, she walked across the street, went up to this 87-year-old senior citizen, called her a bitch, pushed her to the ground. The senior citizen struck her head on the sidewalk, got a cerebral hematoma, and died. And there was a lot of coverage around her about, apparently she was a beloved singing coach and just an incredible woman whose life was cut short. So, you know, on the one hand, right, manslaughter, right, pushing a senior citizen to the ground. And on the other hand, we have Mr. Williams possessing a weapon in the Bronx. And so the portrayal of Mr. Williams, right, was what you would expect, right? Fox, the New York Post, New York City teen charged with shooting NYPD cop, walking free on bond, right? He was not charged with attempted murder. He was not charged. He was actually charged with a reckless assault because it was, everybody agreed that it was an accidental discharge of the weapon. Now, the judge in that case said, I believe it was $250,000 bail and bond in that case. And, you know, Mr. Williams, right, because he's not just your average 16-year-old, right, he's a rising rap star with a signed contract. And so what everybody was shocked about is that this young black teen, unlike most, was able to post bail, right? This was a bail-eligible case. It was bail-eligible before January 1st, 2020, and it's bail-eligible today. $250,000, right? I'm not making $250,000 bail, if that's said on me. But the response was pretty typical. If anybody wants to know why we have a crisis of violence in this city, look no further than this disgraceful release, said Pat Lynch, the president of NYPD's PBA. Then he takes a shot at the judge. Shame on Judge Dennis Boyle for allowing this to happen. Now, Judge Boyle followed the law. Judge Boyle, in his infinite wisdom, thought that $250,000 for these facts was appropriate. The mayor went on to say that this is further proof that our current bail system is failing us. Well, no, Mr. Mayor. This bail determination could have happened 5 years ago, as it did today. So this has nothing to do with bail reform whatsoever. Now, let's go to a portrayal of Ms. Panzienza. You know, fatal New York City shoving suspect, Lauren Panzienza makes bail. That was the New York Post. So in that case, right, this individual, according to the prosecutor, I'm not saying I agree with it, fled the scene and hid for several days. According to the prosecutor, took her cell phone, stashed it at her aunt's house, went to Long Island in Port Jefferson, New York, and hid in her mother's and father's home. When the police caught up and they went to the home, the father said, I don't know what you're talking about, she's not here. 3 days later, she gets a lawyer, she turns herself in to the police, and she's taken for her arraignment. The judge in that case, again, in their infinite wisdom, this case was bail eligible before, bail eligible today, set $1 million bond or $500,000 cash. It's a lot of money. And so Ms. Panzanza's mother, about 2 days later, goes into Rikers Island, breaks out the checkbook, and writes a check for a cool $500,000. Panzanza gets out, and she goes home. So now let's see, you know, the reaction from the police commissioner and the mayor and the PBA and the outrage over the bail determination that led a white woman who pushed the senior citizen to her death. And let's see what the reaction was. Crickets. I had my team search. I mean, I was like, they must have said something. Something. Nothing. No outrage over the bail determination. No calling for that judge's resignation for setting $500,000 bail. They said nothing. Right? And so at the end of the day, we could get into all the statistics and everything we're talking about here and all day today, but it's one system, it's one bail law, and it's two realities. And so what the original bail reform was about was trying to create a more equitable system, a system where somebody isn't held in on bail because they can't make $500 bail, while somebody charged with a manslaughter, well-to-do, can write a check for $500 million and fight her case from her home. Now, I'll wrap it up real quick, but just a kind of a quick check on what's happened. Surprisingly, Ms. Panzanza shows up for her Supreme Court arraignment with her lawyer, and she got remanded by the judge, which is kind of striking, citing that she's a flight risk, despite the fact that she showed up to court knowing she was charged with manslaughter. My guess is the lawyers are going to appeal that, and my bet is bail is going to be reinstated. Mr. Williams' case was dismissed. And the guy who we should have been deemed dangerousness and locked up was dismissed. Why? Because the judge found that the officers lied about how they approached them, why they approached them, and all the circumstances. Right? And so the reaction from the PBA and the mayor wasn't to condone, because when an officer lies, that's called perjury, right? But they didn't condone it. As a matter of fact, they doubled down and said, well, we shouldn't be so harsh on the officer. Right? And so Mr. Williams' case dismissed, right? Because everything that happened was caught on body cam. So the judge looked at the footage, looked at what the officer said, and said, well, officer, you're lying. And his case was dismissed, and we'll see what happens with Ms. Penzianza's case.
Thanks, Dan. It is a very black and white, stark sort of depiction of the media coverage, for sure. Russ, I want to take us upstate. Could you start by saying a little bit about what arraignments look like before bail reform, and then say three things that have changed in your bail practice as a result of the law?
Yeah, is this working?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Town and village courts, there are about 1,300 of them across New York State.
I don't know that it is.
There you go, thank you. Town and village courts are small local courts, sometimes called magistrates' courts, across New York. There are 1,300 of them. In Columbia County, where I'm from, I'm forgetting the exact number, but there are about, I think there are 26. And the judges who serve those courts, by the state constitution, villages, which are sometimes larger than towns, get one judge. Whereas towns, which are sometimes smaller than villages, get two. Judges are elected. A good number of the judges in upstate New York are non-attorneys. There's a large controversy about whether non-attorneys should be judges or not, and that's a different conference. I'm a non-attorney. Judge. I started my career in criminal justice about 40 years ago as a social worker working for legal aid in the Bronx. And my one venture, my one connection to Rikers Island is that I had to go to Rikers Island from the Bronx to visit a client. And what I remember most is not the client, not the conditions, but the fact that it took all day to go to Rikers and back, which was, very inefficient, a waste of resources and such. And also, there were all sorts of other problems. So I'm familiar. I'm familiar with courts that have a large minority, so-called minority, populations. In upstate New York, not including, I'm excluding the cities now, in the outlying areas, by and large, courts there are populated by mostly people who are of white background. When you see if a black person, for instance, comes into my courtroom, I notice because it's an unusual thing. In Columbia County, where we the judges are all the judges actually are white. There's been one black judge in the county, but he retired a number of years ago. In the city, the chief of police is black. All the prosecution staff, the assistant, the district attorney, and the assistant district attorneys, they're all white. The public defender's office is populated by all white attorneys. Probation department, as far as I know, is all white. In terms of courts, before what we're calling bail reform occurred in 2019, 2020, the typical thing would be police officers would bring defendants into the courtroom for an arraignment. When I first started, I've been on the bench for about 20 years. When I first started, the police officers actually served as prosecutors. That number of years later, that was changed, and police were no longer allowed to serve as prosecutors. So the prosecution office took over that duty.
And Russ, if I could jump in, what you meant by that is, so at arraignment, literally be that the judge would ask, like, what are the charges? It would be whatever the police officer, decided upon arrest, and they would request a bail amount as well, sometimes having talked with the DA's office, but sometimes...
Well, yeah, it's actually a little worse than that, in the sense of the police would come in, and they'd have their arrest reports and some background information, scant background information, and sometimes actually the officer bringing the person into court wasn't actually the arresting officer, but simply a transporting officer. Mm-hmm. They would come in. Sometimes you would ask them. The police never had recommendations about bail. You'd ask if they'd been in contact with the prosecution, whether they had recommendations. Occasionally, the answer would be yes. Many times, for more serious sounding offenses, at least in Columbia County, the prosecution would say 20,000, 30,000, so on and so forth, and they were basically extremely arbitrary, numbers. At the time, defense attorneys weren't present. A number of things happened in ensuing years. We now, and this is around the time of bail reform, a bunch of things happened. Some separate reforms, as well as, of course, the pandemic, and they affected different offices differently. The public defender's office got state money to hire a nighttime defense counsel, independent nighttime counsel, to come to arraignments. And so judges, so this is now sort of after bail reform, or about the same time. Judges would get a call, after hours, late in the evening, early in the morning, and say, from the police, saying, we have someone for you to arraign. You'd ask a couple of questions about it. Then you call up the designated defense counsel, and you'd arrange to have him come to the court at the same time that the police and the defendant, were there. And then there'd be a conversation. The police officers just gave you the paperwork. The defense counsel would talk quickly to his defendant, and the prosecution wasn't present. They're never, at least in Columbia County, and it may be different for different counties. They just simply aren't there. There's no recommendation one way or the other for bail. So in essence, it's entirely up to the judge.
And So when we look at the numbers when it comes to bail reform and upstate New York, I mean, one of the, I think, really staggering statistics is before bail reform in upstate New York, the jail population was 80% people held on misdemeanor and violation only charges, because bail could be set on any kind of offense, including very low-level offenses. And that has changed dramatically after bail reform, but the jail population in terms of race and racial disparities hasn't changed.
Right.
Two things. One is, you know, you don't have information about what happens sort of with your cases or your colleagues' decisions in the way that we do for city courts. Mm-hmm. Why is that a problem is basically the question. Then I'll get to the second one once you answer
that. Good. Well, it is and it isn't a problem. I mean, my background is, I've been involved with criminal justice issues for a number of decades, and so I'm familiar with the historical debates about pretrial justice, going back, considerable amount of time, and so I'm also familiar with a lot of the pretrial literature and so on and so forth. So I tend to know what a lot of those issues are from the literature, but also, the court system itself does a good and a wobbly sort of thing. On the good side, they urge justices to treat everybody fairly and decently, respectfully. They urge judges to seek out the least restrictive alternative. They urge, even before bail reform, to take a look at, to consider a person's ability to pay bail.
Yeah.
Then there's just a larger question. Well, they urge those things, but they don't. The court system with town and village justices doesn't do a sufficient amount, I think, in going more deeply into what each of those means and how that applies to the practice of the individual judges. As I was saying earlier, there's diversity in the judges in terms of being a lawyer or a non-lawyer. From, judges don't communicate with each other very much, but from what I've heard from other judges, I don't necessarily see any disparity between leniency and toughness or punitiveness in terms of being a lawyer or a non-lawyer judge.
And so in terms of the public conversation around bail reform, 2 years in, we've seen what it looks like in New York City, where there are advocates, elected officials who are strongly in favor of it, protecting the law, and folks who are strongly opposed to it, and it's a everyday conversation, especially leading up to things like the budget and making changes to the law. Mm-hmm. What's that conversation like in the local news, sort of in the local community in Columbia County or other parts of upstate New York? Does it look like the New York City conversation, or is it different?
Different.
How so?
Well, I've been a judge in Hillsdale for 20 years, and for one term I was a judge in the neighboring village of Philmont. Never, in my experience, has there been a reporter in the court. So, and actually, before becoming a judge, I was actually a reporter for a local newspaper for a certain amount of time. But the local papers don't have resources, and they don't have staff, and I'm not even sure they have the inclination to go into courts, so you don't see them in courts. So there's no coverage. The only coverage of any criminal justice wise is when the district attorney's office issues news releases about so and so was arrested for such and such offense and was released on bail or sent to the Columbia County Jail on $500 bail or whatever it is. I'm not even sure the press releases are that detailed. And that's it. That's pretty much it.
Yeah.
And there's no follow through. There's really no controversy, no public outrage, no public support for that matter.
Yeah. We haven't, as a field, had a conversation about the right solutions to address racial disparities since bail reform went into effect. And so that's my last tough question for each of you. Sort of lightning round, 1 minute if you can. If you could pick one solution you would push in your role to address racial disparities in bail reform, one fix to the bail law, one policy change, one practice change, what would it be? Stan, you look like you're done.
1 minute's going to be tough, but
I will
one of the things, and the prosecutor who was on the last panel, I think he was trying to get at this, is that, you know, there's a gap in services. So a homeless person comes to arraignments in Manhattan, right? He has to be ROR'd if he's charged with a petty offense, like a petty larceny. He stole something from CVS because he was hungry. We give that individual a piece of paper, and we say, see you in 30 days. And by the way, if you're on supervised release, we'll see you tomorrow for an appointment. So that person walks out the door, and guess what? He's homeless. No services. Nobody there to help him. And so what we need, in my opinion, like, why isn't homeless services embedded in arraignments? So you can immediately, right, provide services and try to help that individual. Why don't we have mental illness ACT teams in arraignments? So when we know that that person is odd, right, but it's a mandatory release, why don't we have the ACT teams there to actually help with those individuals? Mm-hmm. Instead, we say, here's a piece of paper, see you next time, and then we're all shocked and, you know, dismayed when the person gets rearrested again.
Yeah.
So I think it's an investment issue and a policy issue, and I think the city should, you know, meet people where they are. And unfortunately, homeless people, mentally ill people, we find them in the criminal legal system.
Yeah. Okay. So that was actually close to a minute, Stan. Nice work. And I will flag that in the budget that did just get passed, I believe the dollar amount is over $600 million, was set aside for mental health services, other kinds of supportive services. And now the big question is it actually going to be implemented in the ways that you're talking about? So who wants to go next?
Just to piggyback on what Stan said, really using that moment where we get people into a place where we're discussing the issues that allowed to get them to this place, and then seeing what we can do moving forward. Because really, when we talk about public safety, this is it's an issue with what we have in the community. And so if you look at the best communities, the safest communities, are communities that are most resourced. And so one of the things that we cannot ignore is the trauma of what poverty does to us as people in the community. And so when we catch this person, when I say catch, I mean they're here, they're there, and we're like, okay, so what is going on in your life? And how do we make it better for you so that we don't keep having you revolving in and out of the system? And so treatment, not jail. We're saying that, you know what? We know that trauma brings about mental health, brings about issues. Thank you for putting on your mask. Thank you. But now we're going to create a service pretrial where, you know, you're going to go to see a therapist. You're going to get back on your medication while you're waiting for us to discuss the crime that got you in here. And so this is shuttling. This is what I wish that $600 million would go to. Pretrial mental health services.
Yep.
By the way, that's my
just
bill.
Just real quick. So Assemblymember Forrest is the assembly sponsor of this bill pending up in Albany. Senator Ramos from Queens is the Senate sponsor, and we really are trying to get it passed. So reach out to your local electeds. Treatment, not jails.
And just one more thing. I'm only saying this because as a nurse, I'm a nurse before an assembly mm-hmm. member.
Yep.
And I just, again, it's like, you keep opening a wound. You're not allowing it to clean out and heal. Yep. What are we doing by just picking up the homeless man and then throwing him back into the state of homelessness? That's nothing. Yeah.
Okay, so two things. First, piggybacking off of you all, I actually think we need to go farther than just talking about services, right? There is and has been an intentional disinvestment from Black and brown communities that is rooted in deep systemic racism. And so we don't just want homeless services in arraignments, although certainly that's a piece of it. People need housing, actual long-term stable housing, not a bed in a night in a shelter. And so I think we need to be talking bigger and grander in terms of how do we actually reinvest? How do we make sure that people have access to safe and stable housing, to jobs, to healthcare, et cetera, in a much bigger way? We have systemically denied people that, and so we have to do that systemic reinvestment. The second thing is I think there's real work to do around judicial accountability. We have had, in the last handful of years, a very real conversation about prosecutorial accountability. There has been an insufficient conversation about judges, and that in cases that are not bail, that are bail eligible, where judges can set bail, we see racial disparities in bail setting. And we saw that prior to bail reform, and the outcomes were worse prior to bail reform because we saw those racial disparities in bail setting on really low-level cases, and now we see it in a smaller number of cases. But I think there is a real question about who sits on the bench. Judges are overwhelmingly disproportionately white. They are overwhelmingly disproportionately from prosecutorial backgrounds. And we see that at every level of the court system. And that, I think, is a real piece of the conversation we need to have. Sorry, that was more than a minute.
I was just about to cut you off, but you knew exactly when to land.
I saw you move out of the corner of my
eye. Katie and I have worked together long enough earlier. We know when to roll it up. I will also say this as part of the data, and I keep going back to the data because I think it is really helpful to look at the numbers and then give them color and texture and put real people and experiences to them. But in New York State, we actually do have for city courts a significant amount of data by judge on pretrial practices, and that's quite unprecedented. We don't have it, though, for the town and village courts. Mm-hmm. And then, Russ, you have the last word. What is the one solution you would push for to address racial disparities?
Well, I'll give three.
You only get one.
Well,
he's got 1 minute, but he can do three solutions.
Okay. Well, the solutions are resources, resources, resources.
Mm-hmm. You did well. Good. You can keep going.
I mean, other. I've been here all day, and I've been extremely impressed by the people who have been presenting, and they've said this over and over and over again, you know, during the course of the day, and most of those people were talking about New York City, and the advantage of being in New York City is that you have a lot of resources. That doesn't mean you don't need more or services redirected, but in upstate New York, for the most part, there aren't the financial, fiscal resources. There's also not the training resources for prosecutors, defense attorneys, judges, probation officers, any of those professions. Mm-hmm. And there's no training for issues like, what's a least restrictive alternative?
Yep.
What do you do when you're trying to assess it, whether somebody can afford bail, and so on and so forth. So again, resources, resources, resources.
Yeah, and I'd say across the spectrum, doesn't really matter where you sit on the sort of is bail reform working or not. I think most folks can get behind putting more resources into the system. So let's turn it over to you all. What questions, comments do folks in the audience and folks virtually? You can tweet, I believe, a question or a comment in. And if you don't mind, just say who you are so we know who we're speaking to and speaking to the microphone.
Okay. Hey, my name is Steven. I graduated John Jay here last May, and I'm currently working in the DA's office in an entry-level position. So I have a question for either of the panelists. So I agree with, I've acknowledged the facts, and I agree with the terms of bail reform. I think it's something beneficial for the state and for the country. However, over the winter, while I was at work, I'm walking towards my office, and I overhear a woman pleading to the desk officer of why her spouse was released without bail regarding a domestic incident. So my question is, what is your opinion with bail reform regarding domestic violence incidents? And I know that in Rikers Island, there's a lot of risks. Going into Rikers, it poses many risks. But who is more at risk? The one potentially going into Rikers or the mother and her kids at home?
So I just want to say that domestic violence charges are bail eligible. Right. So it wasn't that the judge...
Stan, grab a microphone so folks...
Domestic violence charges, even misdemeanors, are bail eligible. So that judge decided not to set bail for whatever reasons. But it wasn't that the judge could not set bail.
Can I add to that? So I think that collectively we have been failing survivors of gender-based and familial-based harm for a very long time. And some of this goes to the sort of moment in the 1970s, the sort of like second wave feminist moment that turned to police and the carceral system as a solution to intimate partner violence. And that was led predominantly by white middle class women who saw that as sort of the solution to this kind of harm. And we have watched it fail for huge numbers of people, but particularly for people from marginalized communities, for queer and trans people who are survivors of familial-based and intimate partner violence harm, for Black and brown people, for anybody in which police come into a situation and there is not the assumption that they should be there helping you. And so I think rather than sort of doubling down on a system that just hasn't worked for survivors, we need a collective rethinking of what it will actually mean to keep survivors safe. And some of it, people have really been asking for, right? There is insufficient housing resources for folks looking to get out of abusive relationships. And the housing resources that do exist are often short-term. They can be hard places to bring kids. They can be sort of collective housing in ways that I think people often find pretty hard. If we gave survivors more of the resources, housing resources, financial resources, other kinds of resources, that is something that people have been asking for and that we have been failing to give people. And so I think your question is a really important one, and I think we need to have a much bigger and broader conversation about how we support survivors of intimate partner violence.
In upstate New York, after bail reform, when a police officer arrests somebody, if there's a request from the victim of an order of protection, the defendant is brought to court right away. I should have mentioned this earlier, but arraignments happen, you know, within hours of arrest. But the police do bring order of protection cases to the court right away, and then there's a question of what to do with that. And in Columbia County, at least, there's like almost all of these defendants are male. Anger issues are involved, et cetera. There's no place to refer them to or send them to. So again, it's resources.
Yeah, no one knows how to talk, because conflict is, you have to learn how to do conflict resolution, even on the part of the victim or the assaulter, right? Yeah. But the idea that people need to have conversations, I've dealt with domestic violence victims, and yes, police come in, pick them up, or drop them off, whatever, but no one tells you how to talk, because he's still the mother of your, he's still the father of your children, she's still the mother of your aunties, uncles, everybody's involved, the neighbor's involved too. So no one's talking about how to move forward with this. Yes, a harm has been done, but we have to move on and heal. And how do we do that? No one knows. Nobody's talking. Nobody's investing in these conversations.
I mean, what we're hearing very clearly is the best investment in public safety and accountability is a third way of support and resources that we just don't have on offer right now. So thank you for that great question, Steve. I have... So I will get to you in just one second. We have one question from the Twitterverse. It's somebody, Mr. Spite Miller from Noble, the New York chapter, and Noble is the National Organization of Black Law Enforcement. And this is Mr. Miller's question. How can local law enforcement organizations provide knowledge-based support to the judicial system and lawmakers? So what role is there for local law enforcement to do education around bail and criminal justice reform?
From what perspective?
Well, answer that question how you'd like. I'd actually be curious, Russ, because you raised the issue of sort of training and information. Are there things that you would want to know from local law enforcement, or is there a role for law enforcement to play in your sort of building your knowledge or education?
Well, there are problems there, because that and this may blend in with the mental health debate too. that puts the police officer in the role of social worker, and they're just not qualified for that. Also, local police officers tend to know everybody. And so, there's an inherent problem of them dealing with people that they actually know. And even with the simple situation of you go to the house, you find out what's happening, you arrest somebody, even that's problematic, personally problematic, mm-hmm. for the officers involved. Yeah. Because they feel, frankly, a little helpless themselves.
Yeah. I mean, that's a really helpful perspective. That as a judge, no, there's a degree of impartiality that's needed in terms of vis-a-vis local law enforcement. Yeah.
The other thing is that, going back to the arraignment session in court, when order of protection requests that come in, there's a defense attorney there, but, typically they don't follow through with any ideas about references or referrals or the like, and the police don't have any referral ideas either, mm-hmm. and so
yeah. Katie, you look like you're going to say something. I would love to jump in on this question because I think it's a really important one too. No, go for it.
So I think one of the really harmful ways we've seen police, and more specifically police unions, engage in this conversation is that they leverage their relationship with local press to push fear-mongering stories solely from a police perspective ahead of any actual fact gathering on the case. This is also a problem of local news who print these articles exclusively from the police perspective. And so in the case that Stan was talking about of C Blue, we had the Post, the Daily News, all of these outlets writing stories from the police perspective about how this teenager had shot a police officer. All of those stories turned out to be wildly untrue, right? This young man was tackled by a police officer and a gun that was in his pocket went off and went through his leg. But by the time the correction comes through, that initial false story is already everywhere. It has already shaped the narrative. And so I think part of it is that we really need law enforcement to not be pushing for press stories sort of at the moment of arrest, to not be pushing for press reports that include only their opinion, to not be pushing for press reports in which they are acting as if there has been fact-finding in a case when there hasn't been. And I actually think that would be the most helpful thing that police officers could do in this conversation.
To pick up on your point, Katie, I think one thing that we should expect of law enforcement as folks who are stewards of not only public safety, but of public confidence in our justice systems is to report accurately. That feels like a basic expectation that I think law enforcement agencies like Noble that are concerned about being on the right side of justice, I think there is a role for you all to play in calling out and naming when we see law enforcement deliberately, manipulate facts or weaponize cases or incidents in inappropriate ways. And we have seen some law enforcement folks actually step up and do exactly that. And when we do, we actually get to have a real conversation about public safety, not one that is weaponized and sort of on the offense or on the defense. So I think there's an important role there.
I think part of what's hard about this is that often that honest conversation requires an admittance of police misconduct. That in the case of C Blue, what comes out is that the police officers wrongfully approached this teenager, that they put hands on him in an inappropriate way, and then they lied about it in court. And so it requires, and I think this is one of the reasons that we have not seen law enforcement frankly, truth tell about this? Is it that it requires you to say that the police officers in the case conducted a wrongful or illegal search, that they did harm in doing so, and then often that they lied about it? And I think we're going to need people to step up and be willing to say that. But I think that is sort of a key part of the problem.
Thanks for that, Katie. And then there was a question over here.
Yeah, so it's not as much of a question, more as just to bring light to like the other side of the perspective, right? I think you mentioned at the DA's office you had a woman coming in wondering why he was released on bail, right? And I think on the other end, I'm a public defender from the Bronx. You know, we have CWs, the complaining witness, right? Oftentimes it is one woman. Calling our phones nonstop, saying the prosecutor's not listening to us. The prosecutor thinks they know my family better than I know my family. I need resources. I need him back in the house so that we can go to couples counseling so that we can properly raise our children together, right? And I think that I've even had a woman come to the courthouse asking to speak to the judge. I want to speak to him since the prosecutor doesn't want to speak to me, right? And so I think that, like you said, the power's really being taken out of the victim's hand, whether it's a man or a woman, right? And I think that people are making assumptions of what's best for this family when we really should be giving them the voice, right, and letting them speak. Because I think in some circumstances, everyone is a victim in that family, the children, the alleged perpetrator, and the victim. And so just to give a little bit of context, because I think both situations do occur.
And if you want to look at that in the context of racial disparities, when I was in private practice, and I had that white, educated Wall Street person charged with domestic violence, first thing I did is I put him in private counseling sessions, right? And then I spoke to the DA, he's getting help. And the approach was completely different than if I was representing an indigent person, right? Charged with the same exact facts. So even the way the prosecutors handle those cases is very different through a racial lens.
Good. Any last questions before we close this out? Thank you. Oh, do you have something to say, Farah? You want to jump in?
I find that sometimes people are like, oh, I was called a criminal justice reformist. And I'm like, that's really weird for me, because I'm just bringing in the perspective of how we do things in nursing, in care, right? That is very much evidence-based. I mean, patients die. We kill patients, doctors, nurses, PAs. Patients die, patients lose a limb. But at some point, we have to have honest conversations with each other. We have to look at the chart, review it, second by second, and we have to be transparent with each other. This interdisciplinary kind of conversation. And what comes out of it is not you messed up, but rather we need to do better. And how can we keep that up? And so I want people to feel like they should be a part of that someone says, I would like training, or I want to give training. I don't balk at that, but rather see it as an opportunity for us to have conversations. So I'm just saying, like, this is very strange for me to be in this space where, you know, no evidence is coming up saying this is how the numbers are. So to even begin the conversation. So this is why I think it's so important for us to seek out how to quantify what bail reform is, and then be able to say, okay, here's where we're messing up and here's how we're getting better. But it boggles my brain. And I have to be, that was a real moment for me, but even on this stage, how like these conversations happen and no real numbers, no real people are then linking up with these numbers and really trying to find a solution to move ahead.
So, Insha, my mother's a retired nurse of 40 years, so I'm all with the nurses. Nurses, we can learn a lot from nurses.
Well, I mean, I think that's a really nice segue to give a big shout out to the Data Collaborative for Justice and John Jay for hosting this conversation, because it is about finding the evidence and looking and not making assumptions or going back to our political positions, but actually having an honest, real conversation about what drives justice, what drives public safety, what drives racial justice too. So one more quick round of applause for our wonderful panelists, for Stan and Farah, Katie and Russ.